Almost as soon as motion picture cameras were invented, people started moving them on every sort of contraption you can imagine. Because it looks better, movies look more alive, more three-dimensional when the camera moves. For years, professional cameras were big and heavy and had to be moved on wheeled dollies and cranes. And I used to love handheld shooting, but I always wanted it to be smooth. Where is it written, after all, that a camera operator has to be any less mobile than the rest of humanity? Well, in 1973, chasing this idea led to the invention of the Steadicam, and ultimately to an Oscar for me in cinema products, and an Emmy because of Steadicam's impact on motion picture and television production. Meanwhile, I got to work on more than 100 movies, and of course I had a great time because Steadicam is clearly the most fun kind of shooting there is. It's in use worldwide now. It's worked on thousands of movies. And now Steadicam technology is available to you. We have come up with a Steadicam for camcorders, the Steadicam JR, a personal stabilizer for you or me or anyone else who has an 8mm or VHS-C camcorder. It's small, it's sleek, it's lightweight, 2 pounds, and it works. It's fairly amazing. It's a kind of magic, mechanical magic in the transistor age. People can't believe it. They follow you down the street to get a closer look at it.
What is that?
Personally, I think it's my best invention. You see your shot on a built-in monitor, even in bright sunlight, just like the big Steadicam. You walk, you run, you glide, you stroll, you climb stairs, and the camera never shakes. You can even ride. The big Steadicam with a 35mm movie camera weighs as much as 90 pounds and costs $40,000. The Steadicam JR weighs 2 pounds, and it's even more fun than the big one. Incidentally, it also makes possible really professional-looking moving camera shots for weddings, for real estate tours, for mini documentaries. It's important that you know that you may need to practice to be good with a JR. It's a bit athletic. But I think you will ultimately enjoy owning it a lot. I mean, I do. I never want to shoot without it.
Looks easy, doesn't it? Fun, easy, no problems. Hang on a second. Don't stop the tape. You better look at the rest of this, because this is definitely a skill, and you've got to learn how to do it. Otherwise,
you could be out of balance.
Or bottom heavy.
Or top heavy.
Or over control.
Welcome to the world of Steadicam JR. It's a very exciting tool, and you may find that it changes the way you make videos forever. However, it's a skill. It takes a little time to get used to the art of flying it and the art of managing the balance and the trimming. We definitely want to help you get through to that point and get through the setup where you join the Steadicam to your camera. So stick with us. We'll get you through that as painlessly as possible. In fact, actually, when you may find that once your camera and the JR are mounted together, you may never want to separate them. The JR can be folded for carrying,
and put in the so-called shoulder mode for conventional handheld shooting. Or even mounted on a tripod, a bit of antiquated gear, but might come in handy. Now the JR setup takes a little time. If you do it properly, you've only got to do it once. That's the good news. Allow yourself a couple of hours for this. Be comfortable, have a good chair, a nice work surface, plenty of light on what you're doing, your TV set nearby with a remote control. If you haven't read the introduction to the manual, well, take the manual and the cookbook out, read the introduction, check along with the steps, and so you can keep up with us here. Don't take anything else out. Obviously, you've already taken out the video, or you wouldn't be seeing me. We'll see you in a few minutes. Stop the tape and go to the introduction of the manual. Hi, welcome back. You've been through the introduction, right, in the manual? Did you find your camcorder in the famous cookbook? Because that has all the things you need to know about how to deal with and set up your particular camera. And you've laid out all the tools you need. Your camcorder should have a charged light or heavy battery, depending on what it says in the cookbook. Screwdrivers, grease pencil, TV remote control, etc. Leave everything in the box for now. We're going to describe the purpose of the system, and we'll get to the folding and unfolding of it in just a minute. Camcorders are unstable because the human beings attached to them are always in motion. It's a sign of being alive. It isn't the up and down motion so much, it is the angular motions that are really bad for your shooting. And of course, if you try and walk with a camera or move around, the fact that you're so strongly connected to it lets these angular motions get through to the shot. The Steadicam disconnects you from your camera, retaining only enough angular influence to aim it where you want. The shape of the JR is designed to move its center of gravity outside the camera, below it. The gimbal won't permit your angular moves to get through to the camera. So it doesn't matter if your hand shakes. Just above the gimbal is the guide, the small surface you use to aim the JR. Since your gripping hand does all the work in supporting it, your guiding hand can retain the extremely light touch necessary to aim the camera without transmitting the shake. The camera is mounted to the stage. The trim controls on the stage make it possible to tune the balance of the system so that it's poised level on the gimbal, but it's ever so slightly bottom heavy. The monitor allows you to see what you're shooting without your eye on a viewfinder, which might transmit motions through to your shot. And of course, having a monitor lets you have the freedom to move around and use your arm extension, which is fabulous. Smile, Bob. Finally, the upper spar and the lower spar distribute the masses of the system, and they position the monitor in a convenient place for viewfinding. Well, the combination of all of these elements works surprisingly well, if I do say so. I certainly hope you enjoy it as much as we have, and if you get good at this, you can make your way through almost any shooting situation and emerge with terrific pictures. You've been very patient. Okay, now let's unpack the Steadicam box and let's check off all the pieces to make sure you've got everything. Here's what you should have. First, of course, is the JR itself, folded in travel mode. Leave it folded for the time being. If you try and unfold it and make a mistake, you might damage something. We'll get to that real soon. An OB light, which is for illumination for close objects and faces. A spare OB light bulb. You get two spare stop blocks, and of course there's already a stop block mounted on your JR. This is normal, this is heavy, this is light. And you get two stop block spare screws. We'll explain what to do with that. You get five weights, two large, two small, one extra small. You get a piece of Velcro. We'll explain what to do with that. You get a rubber wedge that helps stiffen the mounting of your camera. You get two mounting screws, one long, one short. These are locating pins. You get four of them on a tree. They're numbered 1 to 4 in increasing order of size. We'll get to explaining what to do with those. A spare cover for your hinge if you lose it. A video cable. For JVCs, Panasonic, certain side battery-mounted cameras, this is a battery stepper adapter, which allows you to make an easier battery change for those particular cameras. This is a remote pause cable, which runs the pause control circuits on cameras with a make-break type circuit, such as JVCs. Other cameras, the pause control will be available later. You get four batteries, and this is called the study stand. This
can be taped to the edge of a table, and the JR itself can be docked on this item. I would definitely tape it so it doesn't go skidding off here. The JR can be docked on that item to help maybe your setup be a little easier on the arms if it takes a while. And there are other uses for it, we'll explain. Now, pause the tape and turn to section 2 in the manual and unpack your JR. Check off everything to make sure you've got all the parts. We'll see you in a few minutes. So, are you excited? Let's begin to look at unfolding the JR. Watch me for a minute and then go through it when you get back to the manual, step at a time. This is the stage, this is the lower spar, this is the monitor folded down. Remember, we're in travel position. Notice that the handle, the grip, is tucked in between the ribs of the lower spar when you're in the travel position. That keeps it safe, and when you're folding, be sure that it ends up in that slot so there's no damage. Are you ready? Let's unfold the JR into flying mode. Hold the stage with one hand. Unfold the lower spar. Only two positions, either folded or unfolded, and it clicks very firmly into place. This is the upper spar. This is the stage. They fold down 45 degrees. Just like that. Two positions. The monitor folds back 90 degrees. Two positions, either unfolded or folded. That's all this bracket does. It won't rotate this way, and don't even try to do that, or I'll find you somehow. The monitor itself swivels in that bracket to help you adjust the viewing angle. Now let's fold it back up again. The lower spar folds. Be sure that the handle is captured between the ribs of the lower spar, laying flat so it doesn't get damaged and doesn't damage the gimbal. The monitor folds down, and the entire unit collapses gently. Now let's go back to flying mode and I'll show you a variation, which is called shoulder mode. Shoulder mode is by folding only the lower spar up. Be sure to capture the handle properly as we showed you. Open the whale's tail, which is this little bracket right here, and set it on your shoulder. And with the camera here, of course, this is a very comfortable mode if you can't walk around for handheld type shooting. Another variation is called rest mode. Raise up the stage and let the handle be straight down, supporting the stage and giving you easy access to the various parts during setup. Now let's take a really close look at the important parts of the JR. This, remember, is the gimbal. It consists of six very delicate bearings. Just be sure that you never move the gimbal beyond its natural range of motion, otherwise it could be damaged. Down below is the grip. This is what you hold to support the JR. Be sure the gray surface contacts your fingers and is always forward. If you hold the grip backwards, its range of motion is severely restricted and it could get broken. Up above is the guide. This gray ring up above is for controlling the angle of the camera very delicately. Don't attempt to rotate it or move it or adjust it quite yet. We'll get to that real soon. Don't be too eager here. Other controls include the picture brightness knob on the side of the monitor, the pause switch, the pause cable input, both at the base of the stage, the fore and aft trim knob on the side of the stage for shifting the weight of the camera forward and backward, the side to side trim knob at the back of the stage for shifting the weight of the camera side to side. On the right side of the unit, the video in connector, and the 6-volt DC out connector. The upper battery compartment is under the monitor. The lower battery compartment is at the bottom of the lower spar. The store switch, right there, should be left off because that saves the tiny drain of the video power saver circuit when you're not using the unit. Under the unit, at the juncture of the upper and lower spars, is the stop block. It's labeled normal, and it's fastened down by two screws. And it sets the position of the opening of the lower spar. When your camera is mounted on the JR, the reason that it works, and it works very well, is a very special little balancing trick, and I would like to try and explain that to you. It's a trick that involves making the center of balance of the entire mass ever so slightly bottom heavy. Here's how slightly bottom heavy it is. If I hold it out to one side and I let it go, you see that it falls very slowly. Let's take a look at another way of explaining that. Watch this. If you try to balance a bowl on the tip of your thumb, it's not real easy because the center of gravity of the bowl is a bit high and it's unstable. If you flip it over, however, now the bowl is slightly bottom heavy and it's a great deal easier to control, a much more stable object. We will show you how to preload and preset the Steadicam so your Steadicam is slightly bottom heavy with your camera on it, and therefore it'll be a lot easier for you to control and a lot closer to its final operating condition, which is very, very slightly bottom heavy, a slow pendulum. So we'll give you an overview of the ways in which you can get your Steadicam to be slightly bottom heavy, and then we'll send you to the manual to go through the steps one at a time and check them off. The coarsest adjustment of bottom heaviness is by changing stop blocks. There's the normal stop block that came with the unit. I already took the screws out, so I can show you how they work. The heavy stop block lowers the lower spar, therefore lowers the center of gravity. The light stop block sets it rather high up. That's for the lightest possible cameras. By changing that angle, that's the way to make big changes in the center of gravity of the unit. The important thing when you're changing stop blocks is to get it in the right direction. The tab should face into the slot, and the recessed screw hole should be facing toward you. The name, of course, is right down here. A somewhat finer adjustment of bottom heaviness involves adding weight to the lower spar. This will lower the center of gravity in a more controlled manner. Batteries supply the basic weight, obviously, but we supply additional weights. The large ones go in slots between the batteries. The small weights go either under the batteries, laying flat like this, or one small weight can be forced between the two large weights. And the extra small weight goes, if necessary, obviously, in the slot ahead of the batteries. The finest adjustment of bottom heaviness is obtained by rotating the guide, this threaded part above the gimbal, and this raises or lowers the stage. We call it Z, or vertical adjustment. At the front of the guide is a black rectangular button, a latch, that keeps the ring from rotating inadvertently. If this latch is depressed with a fingernail, can you see it here? It allows the guide ring to rotate, and you can turn it full turns. It always locks in when it's faced forward correctly. It should turn quite easily. Don't use the tongue, which is this piece here, and certainly don't use the handle itself as a wrench to help turn it. It's shipped from the factory three turns counterclockwise, which is this way, unscrewed. Screwing clockwise, which is screwing it in. Let's check these three turns. Screwing it clockwise increases bottom heaviness because it raises the gimbal, lowers the stage. Don't bother trying to screw at the last fraction of a turn. Always leave a little bit of margin there. Now, finally, rotate it counterclockwise the number of turns specified for your camera in the cookbook. Oh, one last thing. Always be sure that the tongue is facing forward when you're operating the unit, because if you leave it facing backwards, it can be trashed or broken when you try to fold the unit. Leave it forward where it clicks. Because the center of gravity of each camera is different, the positioning on the stage may be different. And in fact, the gross adjustment of balance over the gimbal is accomplished by the selection of the mounting hole. The fine adjustment, of course, is adjusting the trim side to side and fore and aft. The JR stage has 9 mounting holes. Directly in front of each is a smaller hole for a locating pin. It stops the camera from turning. You'll find the appropriate hole number in the cookbook. Find the correct hole on the stage and mark it with a grease pencil. Be sure the drawing is facing the same way as the mounting plate. There are four locating pins numbered 1 to 4 on the tree. 4 is the largest. The cookbook will specify which one you should use. Just twist it off. Here's our locating pin. It goes in the hole forward of the mounting hole we've selected, which is right here. You can use a coin to tighten it, but don't over-tighten it. If it's tough to start the locating pin, maybe clean the end of it off with an emery board. Before mounting up the camera, let's take a closer look at the operation of the fore and aft and the side-to-side trim knobs, and let's roughly preset them. The side-to-side trim knob works because it shifts the weight of the camera. Do you see this camera mounting platform moving as I turn the knob? Turning it clockwise shifts the weight of the camera this way and makes the entire unit roll in that direction. Just like, think of it as a wheel. The direction you turn it is the direction that will make the unit roll. Coming counterclockwise moves it the other way. You can, if you like, preset the side-to-side trim according to the marks indicated in the cookbook, either left, center, or right for your particular camera. That will be a rough setting. The action of the fore and aft control is a little hard to understand unless you look from underneath and you see that it actually has the effect of moving the gimbal carrier. Can you see that? And again, it acts like a wheel. If you turn it to counterclockwise, it tilts the unit forward. If you turn it clockwise, it tilts the unit to the rear. Once again, the cookbook will give you a preset, which may save you a little time setting up either fore, center, or aft. Now, it's time to prepare your camera for mounting. Accessories have a big influence on the center of balance, so for now, leave them off. We'll balance a fairly stripped-down camera, which is what's specified in the cookbook. Even things like a lens cap, if it's dangling, has a big influence on the balance, so if you're going to use one, make sure it has a place to be stuck on while you're shooting. And certainly have nothing like shoulder straps or anything that can dangle, because they'll be a disaster. The OB light should be mounted. A wide-angle adapter, if you own one, should be off for now. You can balance it up later if you want to use one. Use the lightest battery possible, unless the cookbook specifies the heavy battery. There's certain ultralight cameras that we allow you a heavy battery, but use the light batteries for most cameras. The cookbook has numbers for balance if you want to use the heavy battery, but in the early stages, I recommend going with a light one. The mounting screws come in two sizes, short and long, and use the ones called for by your camera. And be sure that you've got a tape on board, because no tape obviously would have a big influence on balance. Turn your camera upside down and hold it between your knees with the lens facing away from you. Find the small locating hole in front of the threaded mounted hole, because the locating pin on your JR is going to go right into that hole. Put the JR with the monitor facing forward. Invert the JR so the pin goes right into the locating hole. Check that the threaded hole is visible through the selected hole in the JR. Insert the correct mounting screw. If you make a mistake and get the long one in there when the short one is called for, it'll bottom out, and there's some danger of popping the threaded insert right out of your camera, so just be a bit careful with that. And tighten it down. Now, some cameras have a lightweight structure on the bottom, and they may not contact the stage all the way, or they may vibrate a little bit because the structure is a bit light. One of the solutions for that is the wedge we supply you, which can be stuffed in under the gap at the front of the camera and over the mounting platform. This particular camera doesn't have room for it and doesn't need it, but keep that in mind if you do need this solution. Now, when your camera is snugly mounted, fold it down into the shoulder mode and take a look at something. Just a little side note here. Some cameras have a strap holder or various things here that are sharp, and they might scratch the battery cover. So the bit of Velcro we send you can be handy just to make a nice pad under your camera so you can close it up, open it any number of times without scratching the JR. Now let's plug in the cables. The Obi-Light cable can be dressed behind the side strap to keep it from flopping around. It plugs in right here. The video cable plugs into the video in on your JR, which is right there, and is connected to the video out on your camera. And don't leave it hanging down to be in your way. Kind of tuck things in so they don't dangle and they don't change the CG of the camera. Now the JVC and certain Panasonics accept a make-break pause cable that we supply you. Find the remote plug, dress it around so that it can be plugged into the pause plug on the JR, which is to be found right over here. And on those cameras, your pause switch will function. The excitement is building, right? We're getting close here. Let's trim up the unit. Open it up. Be sure it's open fully into flying mode. Remember, the lower spar goes all the way out. Upper spar comes down. Monitor goes all the way up. Now hold the upper spar with one hand until you get ready. Hold the grip with the other hand. Prepare to slide your hand up and down and even study the guide portion while you're actually trimming, because what we're going to do is adjust for level trim fore and aft and side to side with the trim knobs. Now let's see what condition we happen to be in. We have preset the indicators according to the cookbook, but we're very unlikely to be perfectly balanced here. Let's see what's happening. If I let go momentarily, disaster. Tilting forward, maybe even tilting to the side. Hard to say at this point. Let's deal with the fore and aft first. Remember, I slide my hand up to stabilize the unit. Remember, it's a wheel, and the direction I want to roll the camera is the direction you turn it. Discrete full turns. It's a very fine control. Check it. Still a little front heavy. Got one more. Now it's a bit hard to tell because it's trying to fall sideways, so let's deal with that one. The side-to-side adjustment, like a wheel, right? It's falling this way. I roll it as if I was rolling the camera. Discrete full turns. This is as far out as it'll probably ever be when you're first trimming like this. Let's check it again. Oh, a little bit of fore and aft still. Three or four turns, we're there. A little side-to-side, let's get it level. We'll just get it close, that's fine. Now, in case there isn't enough travel, for instance, if I'm still tilted and I've run out of room with the side-to-side trim, that indicates that I've got to change holes, change the camera mounting hole, and move uphill one hole. Another possible hazard is if I keep trimming, but it's never stable, never hangs upright like this for any length of time, that may indicate that it's still top-heavy. And the quick test of that is hold the camera sideways. If it's top heavy, by definition, the camera weighs more than the counterbalancing JR and it will fall this way. If, however, you hold the spar out to one side and it falls, but it falls too rapidly, that's right, boys and girls, it's too bottom heavy. Okay. And if you hold the spar out to one side and it takes just over a second to fall through vertical, what do you know? This one's perfect. That means your JR is correctly bottom heavy. There are three ways to change the balance on a seesaw. You can move the fulcrum, you can change a weight, or you can move a weight. Now, similarly with the JR, you can move the fulcrum by adjusting the Z-axis, by screwing in or out the guide. And that, of course, affects the balance of our little seesaw here. Or you can add or remove weights from the battery compartment. That has an effect, bottom heavy, top heavy. Or you can move the battery compartment itself, move a weight by changing the stop locks. Three choices. Of course, that has a huge effect on the bottom heaviness or top heaviness. Fine tuning of bottom heaviness means adjusting the Z axis with the guide ring. Remember, push in the latch with your finger, turn it counterclockwise, moves the fulcrum toward the lower spar, and makes you less bottom heavy. Screwing it in or clockwise moves the fulcrum of your seesaw toward the camera side and makes it more bottom heavy. If screwing the guide all the way in doesn't provide sufficient bottom heaviness, well, then you've got to add a little more weight and put another weight, the smallest one, hopefully, into the battery compartment. Now let me caution you against something. Once you've added weight to the battery compartment, it will seem to affect the fore and aft balance. Don't use adding or subtracting weight as a method of getting trim. Always use the fore and aft trim controls for trimming. Once you've done that, then you can correctly adjust the Z-axis balance once again, now you've added the weight. If adding weight doesn't work, perhaps you've got the wrong stop block in. Consult a cookbook once again and make sure that you put in the correct stop block, because that is the coarsest adjustment of top to bottom heaviness. If you're too bottom heavy, of course, you'll be unscrewing the guide, counterclocking the Z-axis to reduce bottom heaviness, but keep an eye on the threads as you do so, because see this blank band which is beginning to appear? That's a warning that you're almost out of threads, and it's dangerous to continue unscrewing the Z. Actually, you don't need to unscrew that far, because four turns of the Z-axis is the equivalent of one large weight. So if you get Z all the way out, just remove a weight. Of course, I must remind you then that you're going to have to retrim fore and aft, because removing a weight fools you, makes you think that you've changed the camera's balance. Now here's a useful bit of information. If you remove your OB light, which of course you'll do from time to time, counterclock or unscrew the guide 4 to 6 turns, and that will put you back in trim vertically. When the JR is properly bottom heavy, as tested by our drop test, fine-tune your fore and aft trim, and fine-tune side to side particularly. Use that bubble level as a reference. By the way, it's a good idea to check that bubble level against a bubble on your camera from time to time to make sure that nobody's bumped the monitor and maybe put the monitor out of true with the camera. You can use this bubble for a terrific reference if you're cruising through spaces that have strong verticals. So look at it from time to time as you're going straight along and make sure that your camera's upright. It looks better. Now, when your JR is balanced, move it from side to side. Just hold the handle, let go with the other hand, and check that it stays upright. If it's too bottom heavy, moving it from side to side will cause it to swing like a pendulum. You fix that by adjusting the Z-axis trim. Hold the handle, put your other hand's thumb and finger on the guide ring just above the gimbal, and try this. Another test of correct bottom heaviness is that you can tilt the camera up and hold it up with ease. If it's any work at all, it's too bottom heavy. If you've been balancing for a while and your hands are getting tired, you have permission to use the steady stand. Just tape it securely on the edge of a table. Make sure there's room under it for the lower spar to swing. The hole in the bottom of the handle docks on the stand. And now you're able to use both hands to trim and to adjust the fore and aft and side to side. This, by the way, makes a reasonably good surrogate tripod if you're stuck somewhere and have something to shoot that goes on for a while. It's quite steady. Or you can go off and get in your own shot. I'll see you in a minute. If you're balanced, congratulations. If your camcorder, however, is not in the famous cookbook, don't worry, we'll help you get balanced from scratch. So we're going to send you to the manual, to the section called, believe it or not, Balancing from Scratch. Now, the only thing we'll bother showing you right now on the video is how to find the correct mounting hole on the JR. Number one, find where your camcorder balances, on your thumb or on a pencil or something. Find out where its balance, center of balance is. Kind of hold it with the other hand and find out the closest place where it almost balances. Doesn't have to be exact, but get it kind of close. Now, mark that spot with a grease pencil. Now, invert your camera between your knees again. Remember, there's it's the camera's center of balance. Turn the JR stage upside down and put it nearby. Make a mark right here. This is where the camera's center of balance should match up to. This mark, which is between hole 5 and hole 8, should be directly over this mark when you mount the JR to your camera. Well, you notice the camera's mounting hole has this sort of relationship to the center. On the JR, this hole, which is hole number 7, has the same relationship. So we'd expect it to be hole number 7. We'll put that mark over the camera's mark. And sure enough, there's the threaded hole, which I can see right through the JR hole number 7. And that's where your mounting screw will go. Now we're ready to fire up the electronics. Turn on the store switch. Now fire up your camcorder. Adjust the video with the green video knob so you get the best image. If the monitor only flickers when it's activated, or if it's fuzzy or distorted, it may be a sign that your batteries are low or dead. Hold the JR about chest high in a comfortable shooting position and adjust the monitor for the best viewing angle. Remember, we're not adjusting the monitor yoke, we're adjusting the monitor itself, and this adjustment won't affect the balance of the unit. Test the OB light by turning it on briefly. Remember, you must be sending video to the monitor because the OB light shares that circuit, so it goes on and off with the video. However, it has its own switch if you want to turn it off by itself. The OB light and the monitor will run for nearly 2 hours, and the monitor alone will run for almost twice that. When you're through using the Steadicam, don't forget to turn off the store switch. Well, that finishes the setup section. You probably won't need to watch this section again, so set the counter of your VCR to zero. The stuff that's coming up is the operating section. It's terrific material. You may want to see it more than once. So you can always rewind to this point and don't have to wade through the setup stuff again, okay? This is what it's all about. The gimbaled handle means that you're isolated. Your body angle, the angle of your hand, none of it gets through to the shot. You're free to move it, reposition it, boom up, shift. Has no effect on the camera's angle. One hand, your choice which one, supports the grip. The angle of that hand doesn't matter. You can't pan with it, you can't tilt with it, you can't really influence the camera's position unless you go up so far that your hand bumps it. So stay down somewhere underneath, use this hand to support it. This hand supports all the weight. The other hand, whichever one that is, thumb and finger touch this cylinder right here, the guide. The thumb and finger of that hand are what you use to pan and to tilt and keep it level. Those two functions don't overlap at all. This hand positions the camera. This hand is responsible for where it's pointing, okay? And remember that on an isolated floating object like this, if it starts panning, you've got to stop it panning. This is very important when you're going through doorways, for example, and deciding to make a turn as you go through. You've got to start the pan panning and stop it. Otherwise, continue on back to where you came from. Here's another look at the finger position for panning and tilting on the guide. Use the tip of your thumb and finger. Make sure that your fingers don't bump the stage and that your fingers and hands don't bump the upper spar. Panning, tilting. It makes beautiful panoramic shots of spaces, and it's sufficiently inert to continue panning right through the entire room. It'd be very hard to do something as uniform and pretty as that with a geared head and a professional camera. While we're at it, I'll show you the grip for a very exotic style of operating called one-handed operating. This so-called intergimbaled handle, which consists of the grip and the guide, is also designed to let your hand shift up one notch, so the second finger is now under the notch of the handle, and your thumb and finger in this position now do pan and tilt. But you'll notice that I'm supporting the camera very strongly with the bottom of my hand. I'm very lightly touching for panning and tilting. And the way to do it is to start a pan with your thumb and finger, and I use my whole arm as a crank to get it going. I get it going, I stop it, I tilt by using my entire arm, tilting up and down. This allows you to not have two hands in use and to, for instance, reach out and open a door with the other hand, or get lunch or whatever else is required. When you're panning to the right, bend the wrist of the supporting hand so the front spar and monitor don't hit you. When you're panning to the left, bend the wrist of the other hand so that you have clearance and you have the maximum amount of reach all the way around the body. Thank you. have between us a depressing 25 years of Steadicam experience. And we've shot about 300 films between us, I think, right?
Yeah.
I've shot, by my last count, 151 films.
I think I counted, and I think yours was 149.
Yeah,
mine's
sure.
151.
Sure, sure. Let's take this baby for a spin. What do you say? Oh, Alan, I guess you better stay here. It's sad, isn't it? Tripod. Terrible. Okay.
Okay. Are you ready for a simple straight-ahead shot? We'll show you the whole technique, and then when we're finished, you can stop the tape and try it yourself. This is called the missionary position. Simple, straight ahead. One hand holds the camera. One hand pans and tilts. In my case, the right hand's holding the camera, and the left hand's panning and tilting. And of course, make sure that you're trimmed for the shot you want, because every time you let go with the left hand, you don't want the camera flying away to some other shot. For instance, if I'm not trimmed correctly, every time I let go, the camera tilts up. If I am trimmed correctly, watch this. If I am trimmed correctly, I let go, the shot stays the same. So, we ready? Let's try this. Here we go. Missionary position, straight ahead. Left hand very gently on the camera. If I don't want to move it, I leave it alone. If I want to pan, I come in, start the pan, stop the pan. Just thumb and finger very gently. Doesn't matter where this hand is, as long as it stays out of the way of the other hand. Panning, thumb and finger. As soon as you can, let it go. Now, if you think that was fun, wait till you see this. The Steadicam is not connected to you. It's free to be aimed in a different direction than you are facing, and that's very nice. You don't have to go through life. If you want to shoot sideways like this, or this side like this, and if you want to be ahead of somebody, which is a very common shot, I think in my feature career I must have made hundreds of shots preceding the actors. You very seldom get to follow them, which is easy. So, do you have to back up? Not necessarily. There's another mode called the Don Juan, which is like this. This is very convenient. You can roll right along, you can travel, you can shoot somebody to the rear of you. Your peripheral vision tells you where you are. And it can look quite good. The way it's done is like this. This wrist bends a little bit, just like this. But it's the same grip, if you notice. I'm backing up. I'm Don Juan. I didn't change my hands, I just allowed my hand to take a new position. See it? This is backing up, missionary. This is Don Juan. Here's a little reminder. Remember that you must constantly trim fore and aft, which is this knob, if you want the camera to take any special position. I want to tilt down over this balcony. I trim forward. Makes it easy. I want to look up at the ceiling. I don't just hold it up because I have to exert force on it continuously. If I let it go, it would fall back, right? So I trim so that the camera will look up. Notice how many turns I did there, quite a few. This is a very fine micrometer stage and it takes quite a bit of adjusting. And the technique is to do it in quick turns, as we told you. Now, watch, now we hold the ceiling and high up with no particular effort. Now I trim for normal. You don't do this in the middle of a shot. You only do it when you are preparing for a shot, so it's something you do in advance. Now, if you're shooting somebody who is less than tall, let's say, it actually pays constantly to be trimming for the angle that the camera hangs. And that way, you don't have to exert any effort to keep the camera aimed where you want it. Similarly, if you're shooting somebody who's tall, it pays to trim the headroom back. You actually find that you trim almost for every shot, because this is the most common need for adjusting the angle that the camera hangs fore and aft. See that? Almost with no hands on the camera, it holds that angle. If I hadn't trimmed, that wouldn't be the case.
Another way of dealing with the height of the subject is using the actual rig and arming up and down. If the subject's tall, you'd be up here. If the subject is less tall, you're now down here. If you're shooting a child, you might even want to get down like this. It's also, the lower you get, the more dramatic it is. All this can be controlled simply by moving the camera up and down.
Control of the boom height is one of your best weapons, and you can boom high, you can boom way up over your head. If somebody's shoes happen to interest you more than their face, well, you can be right down on the deck. Shoot a shoe commercial. Just be sure to not drop kick your camera right out of the set.
Before we get completely away, let's have a quick review of the various folded modes, shoulder mode and folded mode. From flying, what do you do if you want to set this camera down? The fastest way is to go into shoulder mode like this, and it will sit quite happily on the table, just like that. See that again, this is flying mode. Tilt it up a little bit so the handle guides down inside, and there you go. That can happen quite quickly. This is called shoulder mode because if you use the famous whale's tail, it sits very comfortably on your shoulder and allows you a position for very comfortable and quite stable telephoto shooting if you're sitting in the stands and you can't walk around. This is for when you can't walk and take advantage of the stabilization. In addition, you can put an add-on handle in the forward tripod hole provided here. And I must say, this is almost criminally comfortable now, because you just can be here at full telephoto and looking extremely good and viewfinding with both eyes. And the ultimate folded mode is for traveling. And that's in the shoulder mode, except squashed down, basically, with the monitor folded forward. The camera can be carried comfortably on the camera's side strap. And this isn't a bad way to walk around with it if you're touring someplace. Just be careful if the basher light is on that you don't inadvertently bang it into somebody and knock it off. Usually the basher light is completely useless outdoors or in a really bright environment, so you needn't even bother mounting it up. And I'll give you a quick tip for rebalancing the camera with and without the light. Without the light, you counterclock the Z adjustment four turns. That provides the rebalance slightly as required in fore and aft. And now that provides the correct bottom heaviness approximately with or without the light, okay? And when you put the light back on, clockwise the Z adjustment four turns. It is true, I hate to admit it, it is true that it does weigh something. It's not weightless, okay? All right, it does weigh something. It does act like it's weightless, but unless you've got a really good imagination, after a while, pains in your arm will tell you that in fact it does have weight. So there are some techniques to help you through that, one of which is shoot shorter shots. Another technique, however, which I want to show you is it's okay to hook the little finger of your guiding hand under the handle or under the fingers of your other hand and help lift with the second hand, and you can still guide and pan and tilt just fine. Okay? Another technique is to change hands. It helps to practice with both hands. You go up one hand and hold the ring, let go of the handle, and then pick it up. It makes a bit of a jolt in your shot, but it does work. But don't get fancy, all right? Don't try to throw it from hand to hand. I mean, that basically isn't a good idea. But once you've changed hands, then of course you're starting over again in terms of your muscles.
If you're shooting upstairs, trim so that the camera aims up. Makes it a lot easier. If you're shooting down, going ahead of somebody, trim so the camera hangs down. It also helps to not be real bottom heavy, so you can undo the Z-axis one turn so that the camera really makes it easy to tilt down. Well, you're right, I look at another trick, which is using the boom height helps you to keep the camera aimed at the person who's following you up the stairs. In this case, April. So let's go, April, let's show this off. She's rising. Now, as I start across the landing, I boom down a little bit. I continue up as she rises. I boom down because I'm on the stairs ahead of April. Now I continue at this height. I'm on the landing. She's rising in my shot. I'm rising up the stairs ahead of her. So I boom down. Don't try this unless you got a lot of practice. Instead of using tilt all the time for high and low subjects, use the boom. It's a lot easier. Notice my young friend here. I boom down to see her rather than looking down, looking like this. And also, instead of panning for an uneven subject, try and use your speed of motion. In this case, I'm going to use the speed of my arms. Now watch, here we go. She's going to walk fast, slow, we never know when, and I accelerate and decelerate by using my arms. Oop, almost fooled me there, that was good. Tricky.
Now, it's possible to have a lot of fun with this thing. Now, keep in mind, when you're operating, it's much more fun when you're going along. If you want to look in a doorway, use the doorway and arc around. Looking like this. We'll start that here. We'll start the same thing. We're coming around here. See the way I keep the doorway on the right-hand side? It's much more interesting. Come along here. Sliding into the room. Sliding by. Okay, now watch the way I come around this turn here. Instead of waiting until I get into the hall, I utilize the wall on the right-hand side to make the turn. Much more fun, much more interesting.
You are going to be there. Well, that's what I thought.
Okay, now I'm boomed down. I'm actually at her height at the moment. I go. Now I'm following her, watching what she sees. She turns. Keep her in frame.
O-P-T-O-M-U-I.
Stay wide enough where you see what she's going to be seeing. Now, because you have peripheral vision, you can watch where you're going. You don't have to worry about hitting things because you see them outside the frame.
One-handed operating. Watch this. You can remove the panning hand from the guide, but you've got no way to pan or tilt. This hand has no influence on anything. So what do? Hold the guide, shift your hand up one notch on the handle. This frees up the thumb and finger. And the thumb and finger can now pan and tilt for you if you're very gentle with it. And fly along. If you want to tilt up, use your whole hand. If you want to tilt down, use your whole hand and elbow. If you want to pan, just crank it around and reset like this. If you come to a door that you want to open or close, you've got a hand free to do it. I hope somebody has a key to that office.
One of the great tricks it would be impossible to do without a Steadicam unless you were into second story work is going right through windows. Now watch this handoff here. This is hot technique. Even Hollywood has trouble with this one.
The best way to do this in a car, of course, is to try and brace your hand, but give yourself a little room to take out the up and down motion of the car. Clean your windshield. Always good to clean your windshield. And then just try and influence the camera as little as possible. Get rather wonderful views of the local scenery out the window and try and avoid the bits of the car in the foreground.
Talk about having a responsible, reliable driver.
Helps to interview your driver. You will drive carefully, won't you, Matt?
Sure thing, boss.
And you will decelerate and accelerate rather gently, right? And you will go over no more bumps than you need to, right, Matt? You won't drive crazy, will you?
No, sir.
Okay. If you're shooting in a vehicle, another thing that can be helpful, just so that your bottom of your camera doesn't become a long, slow pendulum when you're accelerating and braking, can be very useful to counterclock the Z-axis, which means less bottom heavy, one or two turns, so that the camera is very, very slightly bottom heavy. Check your trim. So now when you're in a vehicle,
it's good on the monitor.
Support it with one hand. Pan and tilt with the other and let the stabilization system work. Let it just lock up the world for shots, traveling shots that are fairly amazing. Smooth.
out, Ted.
Good.
I'm extremely dizzy now, but it doesn't affect my shot.
One of the great things about this is you're actually able to get the same height as the kids. So now that you become part of their world rather than part of the adult world looking down at them all the time. You have unlimited mobility, so no matter where they go, even if you don't know what's going to happen, you can follow it.
You begin to get into one of the joys of the moving camera, which is that objects move, appear to move in the foreground. And the geography of your shot becomes much more interesting. There are not just what you're presented with standing there, but all the reveals, the three-dimensional qualities of the moving shot, the spaces opening up. All to add a little interest to the proceedings. It's exciting, too, shooting the crowd at an exciting sporting event, shooting the crowd, the tremendous excitement of sport, the agony of defeat, the thrill of victory, crowd rapt attention. Notice how important the booming is, the opportunity to move up and down on the boom. Watch as the takedown occurs. Just lowered about 5 feet.
I'll take about one.
And I'm shooting telephoto now. Quite a telephoto lens. About mid-telephoto. And you see, if you've got good autofocus, it looks great. Circling around. Careful that your camera's mounted really well so that there's not a lot of bounce, because it really, see what I mean? If I shake, a telephoto really shows up. Be sure your camera's mounted, braced front and rear. Just your basic wrestling action. This happens to be a brother-sister team.
Watch Ted's style of hand grip here now in the shoulder mode. You can follow action very quickly, even full telephoto, which is what he is here. And he's viewfinding with a monitor, using his peripheral vision to see what's happening outside the frame. You can follow action very quickly this way. Also, you can hand focus if your autofocus is less than wonderful. This is a really good style of shooting, if you can't walk around.
When you're doing this, try and keep your the camera isolated from your steps by booming up and down periodically. Let your body go down the steps, but let the camera just take one straight line.
Follow along.
Darling, this move's not that special quick drying of sausages. I mean, you know, I'm standing out there with a hot water.
Someone's in the bathroom feeling hot water.
What?
Use your feet to navigate.
Oh, sorry.
I frequently find out where I am by touching with my feet, feeling for what's going on, you know? Hey, it's a tactile organ, you know? Where am I here? Okay, there's the chair. Fine, no problem.
There's no other device you can do this shot with. 360 degrees right around the couple. Wherever they go, you go.
Yeah.
It's one thing to shoot a stationary portrait. It's another thing to actually be able to shoot a tight close-up and be able to move around it. Watch the background change.
And you look at each other with that.
It adds a whole other dimension to your photography.
One and two. And then we go into other steps. Closer. All right? Okay? Raise it. Yeah. 1 and 2, 3 and 4. You go out. So you come real close. Come on, put it around my neck. That's it. All right. Hold that right now. Don't worry. 1 and 2, 3 and 4. 1 and 2, and down you go, and just keep it going. Going, all right?
Now, it makes a lot of sense to use this tool to shoot real estate, but there are a couple of cautions that we really ought to give you here. It is not magic. You don't just sort of grab the camera and race through a house like you were shooting Fright Night 7, you know what I mean? There's no sort of magic bullet here that will make your real estate videos look good. It isn't even recommended, in fact, that you move all the time in a house. So let us give you a couple of quick tips in case you want to make a sales film to help sell real estate, either professionally or to sell your house or to help a friend sell a house. I think that having tried this a couple of times, and honestly, I made a very bad real estate video the first time I tried it because I made the sort of horror film mistake. What I finally learned to do was a very nice, gentle traveling shot that shows your audience how the rooms are connected in the house, showing them the track that leads from room to room, maybe even commenting on the layout as you do it. And then go back and individually look at the rooms. And it's very important to use the old pause switch. You know, if you start a pan, click the switch just as you start it. And then click it off right in the middle of the pan, or click it off before the pan is ended. If you're using a camera that allows this kind of pause, if you have an external pause switch, use that. It doesn't make a lot of sense for the average real estate video to go into a big editing session. You can edit it in the camera. What does this mean? It means you've got to be a little careful to plan the whole thing out in advance. So before you start shooting, don't get too excited. Just intellectually decide what is the order of the rooms you want to see and what really is your plan. And then shoot one, play it back. Take a look at it. Make sure you've really got it. With the investment of a half an hour of work, you can probably get a really nice video on almost any piece of real estate if you've practiced and are good at the JR. Another tip is, of course, to turn all the lights on in the house, even in a daylight shot, because it brings up the walls and the odd corners, and let the camera do an auto color balance of the house. So let's go and take a quick walk around and see if there are any tips for a real estate video. Watch this. You stand in the doorway, begin the camera moving. Just get it started with your finger and let it carry right on around the room. And if you care to, make a very slow move as well. Remember to keep trimming for what you really want to see in the shot. And use your boom, use the boom opportunities to also help you watch. I'm going to start a pan. I'm going to boom up because this is a high detail rather than having to tilt up. Boom down to show the table. Continuing to pan. These are terrific techniques for a room like this. And then just at the end, begin to get moving. So the fireplace pays off. And cut. Nice. That was good.